Hello, my name is Paul Moss. I'm Deputy Head of the College of Medical and Dental Sciences in the University of Birmingham. And in the next few minutes, I'd like to introduce some of the principles of vaccination against SARS-CoV-2. This shows an outline of the virus structure. And at the bottom in the cartoon, you can see the four major proteins in the virus: nucleocapsid, spike, envelope, and membrane. And I want to focus today on the spike protein, which is the target for most current vaccine regimens. This is a structure of the spike protein. It has two forms: a globular form at rest, and then when activated, a rod-like form. You can see what a beautiful structure it is. And in this little video, I can bring this alive by showing you how the virus binds to your cells. So here we will see the spike has two domains, the external red S1 domain. And you can see here binding to your cells, perhaps in the nose. And after that happens, the spike is cleaved and this S2 domain unravels onto your cell from the virus. And then two of these spike proteins pull the virus envelope down almost an anthropomorphic way to make sure that the virus can enter into your cells. This is a representation of from my colleague Gavin Screeton in Oxford of the top of the spike domain. It's called the receptor binding domain. And you'll see in green the area of the receptor binding domain that binds to the protein ACE2 that allows entry into your cells. And for vaccination, we need to induce antibodies that can block this interaction. What Gavin's been able to do is to see where antibodies from people who are naturally infected with the virus bind onto this green receptor binding domain. And the valuable antibodies, the ones in red, they are neutralizing and they stop the virus being able to stick to your cells. And that's what vaccination must achieve. Here, Gavin's actually looked at how the antibodies bind by cryo-electron microscopy. You can see this antibody sitting right on the stop and stopping the RBD from binding to your cells. This antibody, fascinatingly, is stuck at 90 degrees, but still very effective. So, vaccination. Of course, this is Dr. Jenner's house in Gloucestershire. Proud British history of vaccination. And we're very fortunate that we have three effective vaccines against SARS-CoV-2. How did these come about? Well, one of the major rules of biology is that you get DNA, the code from your mother and your dad, and then as you use it in cells, you get a transcript formed called messenger RNA, which is decoded into proteins, the building blocks of your body. And most all vaccines in the past, such as the one that Dr. Jenner used, were proteins, which were injected into your body to make an immune response. But the first and important vaccine candidate for SARS-CoV is mRNA. So it's injecting the code for the spike protein, which your body then makes itself and induces an immune response. So we have the different classes of vaccine platforms at the current time: mRNA vaccines and the adenovirus-based vaccines. We will also see introduced soon the protein vaccines and inactivated whole virus vaccines. This is the first report of the efficacy, the clinical efficacy of the mRNA vaccine. And you'll see here two groups. In blue, people who did not have the vaccine, and this was the number of infections they got over time. You can see gradually increasing. Whereas in red, the people who received the vaccine, you can see that new infections plateaued out very early, 95% efficacy. And you can look at very, very early. You can see protection happening at 11 days after vaccination, remarkably early and remarkably effective. And of course, the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunization has prioritized the different groups which will get the vaccine. And you can see that in the UK, we're racing through these groups very effectively, because we know that age is the major determinant of mortality. But the virus can mutate. The mutation rate for this virus is low. It's lower than influenza and HIV, and that gave us a lot of hope initially. But we now know that this rate of change at one or two per month can accumulate and lead to all these different subtypes of variants of virus, as you can see here. And one of these variants, this E484K variant, can lead to loss of some of those antibodies and loss of some immune recognition. So we have a number of challenges. We don't know how long the immune response will last after vaccination. We don't know the response in immune suppressed patients, such as those with a cancer diagnosis. We don't know if we can mix and match the mRNA and adenovirus vaccines, and that's being tested. And we need to overcome these variants, either by generating very high levels of antibody or getting a specific vaccine against the variants. And of course, our College of Medical and Dental Sciences is playing a strong position in this area. We're leading the National Core Studies Program with Patrick Valence and Chris Whitty, and we've invested a lot of money on studying vaccine immune correlates with my colleague, Professor Kearns, leading on a study of patients with a cancer diagnosis. And my own team looking at immune senescence, people over the age of 80 years, and seeing how effective they are at generating immune response to vaccination. So, vaccines have been phenomenal in the last 6 months. They offer a way to control this pandemic. We do have major challenges, but we're starting to identify those. And as ever, staff in our college have made a major contribution in this important global effort. Many thanks.